Hey, fellow scientists, it's Justin here. This is something you may not know about me, but, hold on.
There you are. Yeah, so I love houseplants, and I somehow just keep acquiring more. And that's all well and good. The problem is, some of my plants are thriving, but others, well, they look like they could use some attention. I've been giving them all the same amount of water and sunlight, but maybe different plants don't need the exact same treatment to thrive. Can you help me learn more about plants so I can be a better plant parent? By the end of today's lesson, you'll be able to explain the functions of various plant structures and explain how adaptations can help plants to survive. Let's get into it. Within the plant kingdom, there are more than 300,000 different known species. That makes for a lot of diverse shapes and sizes of plants. But when we look closely at how a plant is structured, we'll see that everything boils down to a function for either photosynthesis or reproduction. Are there any plant structures you're already familiar with? Let's start with the basics. Oh, excuse me. I mean, let's start with the base. If you've ever been tasked with pulling weeds from the ground, you probably noticed the roots. Roots anchor a plant to the ground so it doesn't get displaced by weather, passing animals, or even a good roll down a hill. But that's not all they do. Roots act like a sponge, absorbing water and nutrients from the soil. But water can't just stay in the roots. All the cells in a plant need water to function. The water has to be transported throughout the plant. That's where the xylem comes in. The xylem are small tubes inside the stem of a plant. They transport water up from the roots and throughout the plant. Water evaporating from a plant's leaves creates pressure that sucks the water up, just like when you suck on a straw. So, next time you cut a flower or snap a twig, keep an eye out for these tubes. So, the xylem delivers water throughout the plant. Great, that's one key ingredient for photosynthesis down, but do you remember the other two? Yeah, plants need water, sunlight, and carbon dioxide to perform photosynthesis. Luckily, the leaves are optimized for absorbing both of the remaining ingredients. The chlorophyll inside the chloroplasts in a plant cell absorb light energy from the sun. Leaves, which are usually flat and wide, are able to absorb a lot of light. On the underside of the leaves are stomata, or small pores that take in carbon dioxide. Since all three ingredients are present, most photosynthesis occurs in the leaves. Photosynthesis produces sugars, like glucose, that the plant can use for energy. This is the stuff that the mitochondria convert into usable energy. Cells all over the plant need glucose, not just the leaves. So just like how water is transported through the xylem, glucose is transported through tubes called the phloem. Awesome! All of these structures help the plant perform photosynthesis, which allows all of its cells to have energy. But plants aren't out there running marathons or solving math problems, so what do they do with all that energy? Plants use the energy from photosynthesis to grow, get bigger, and undergo even more photosynthesis. But on top of that, a large portion of plants' energy goes towards reproduction. There are several different ways plants reproduce or create seeds that will turn into new plants. But by far the most common method is the one used by flowering plants. Creating the seeds that will hopefully become new plants all comes down to pollen, the yellow, powdery stuff that gets all over cars in the spring and tends to make sneeze, excuse me. Pollen is found on the stamens of a flower, which are the filaments that stick out from the center. They're especially noticeable in plants like lilies. To make a new seed, pollen has to be transferred from the stamen of one flower to the pistil of another, which is the part in the very center of a flower. This is called pollination. Can you think of any ways pollen from one flower can be transferred to another? Maybe a breeze could blow by, or a farmer trying to produce new seeds can transfer the pollen by hand. The most common way a flower is pollinated, though, is through visits from pollinators, like bees and butterflies. As bees go from flower to flower, collecting nectar to make honey, pollen sticks to their fuzzy little bodies. They pollinate flowers without even knowing how helpful they're being. Being. The plants aren't just leaving pollination up to chance, though. Plants grow petals that are bright and colorful to help them stand out and look attractive to pollinators. Aw, thanks, Mia. I guess it works on humans, too. The structures we've reviewed so far can be found in almost all plants. They're what they need to survive. But we know that plants can look massively different from each other. Why do you think there are so many different types of plants? Record your thoughts in your guided notes. Plants have adaptations that help them to not only survive, but to thrive in their environments. An adaptation is a specialized body part or behavior that benefits an organism in its environment. For example, some plants live in areas where water is hard to come by, like deserts or extremely cold climates. Pine trees, for example, are well adapted to environments where water is limited due to frozen soil and low rainfall. Instead of having big, wide leaves, they have thin, needle-like ones, which limit how much water is lost to evaporation. Succulents, like aloe, also have adaptations for low water conditions. These plants have thick, fleshy leaves or stems that store water, allowing them to survive extended periods of drought. Plants have adaptations to help them thrive in more than just dry environments. In areas where the nutrient levels in the soil are low, there are plants that have adapted to be carnivorous. Carnivorous plants, like the pitcher plant or the Venus flytrap, consume insects for energy. Other plants are parasitic, attaching themselves to larger plants like trees and stealing their nutrients rather than absorbing them from the ground. Mistletoe is a classic example of a parasite that's also quite festive. Did you know that even fruit is an adaptation? Some plants that don't want to be eaten by certain predators developed fruit with capsaicin, a chemical that drives many animals away because of its burning sensation. But we humans use it to spice up our food, like in my famous spicy marinara sauce. Have you seen any plants with interesting structures? How do you think those structures might help it to survive? Record your thoughts in your guided notes. Let's review everything we've learned today. Plants have specialized structures that help them to perform photosynthesis and reproduce. In order to produce new seeds, pollen from one flower's stamen must be transported to another's pistil. Plants have many different adaptations to help them survive in their environments. To learn more about plant structures, be sure to check out the activities and practice questions that go with this lesson. With hundreds of thousands of different types of plants, it makes sense that it's not one size fits all when it comes to plant care. My apartment is not these plants' natural habitats. I need to keep in mind the conditions they thrive in when I take care of them. I guess I better get researching. Remember, scientists, curiosity is the architect of discovery. See you next time! Hey, hey.